Order, please. Orders of the day, daily routine. We now recognize the Honourable Government House Leader.
Mr. Speaker, it's the understanding of the three House Leaders that they will we will not do a late debate tonight at the moment of interruption, and that is, I believe, and I think unanimous consent of the House, it's my belief that under Rule 5 that we will carry that debate subject over to the next late debate, which would be Tuesday the 16th. Agreed?
All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
All those against say nay. Thank you. The late debate now, the subject matter will be moved over till Tuesday, April the 16th. A daily routine, presenting and reading petitions. Tabling reports of committees. Tabling reports, regulations, and other papers. Statements by ministers. Can I get unanimous consent? We'll take a short little recess here for 5 minutes or so we can restart it. It's up to all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those against say nay. We'll take a short recess and get back very shortly. Thank you. Order, please. We will now continue on with our afternoon. We are in the daily routine, statements by ministers. I will now recognize Honourable the Premier.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Nova Scotia is mourning the loss of Rattaya Parsons, a young girl who has touched the lives of people all across the province and around the world. I wanted to reach out to the members of this House and to all Nova Scotians to assure people that I will do everything in my power to create a community that is equipped to prevent these situations rather than a community that struggles to find a way to deal with them. The issues that this situation have brought forward, painfully forward, and into the view of the world are ones that respect no particular departmental responsibility. They do not belong to, within, or within some particular system or process. They cross all of the visible and invisible lines. And that is why this government and this province has taken a coordinated, comprehensive, and thorough approach to these difficult and disturbing issues. Mr. Speaker, I have appointed Marilyn Moore, the minister responsible for the status of women, to coordinate the work of all relevant departments: education and early childhood development, justice, community services, and health and wellness in the days ahead. She will work with all of the ministers to ensure a timely, effective, and thorough response and a review of everything the government and our partner agencies can and should do to support Nova Scotians. She will have the full-time support of the Associate Deputy Minister of Community Services, Lynn Hartwell, to work through these complex matters. I have asked her specifically to assess the status of work on the supports and programs to address individuals who have or may face sexual violence. Mr. Speaker, I want Nova Scotians, particularly our young people, to know that if they are being bullied, if they are suffering, they can and should reach out for help. They can call 811, they can call 211, the province's mental health crisis line, or the kids' help phone. Links to all of these numbers and other supports are available on the main page of the government's website at novascotia.ca. And people should know that they can always visit their local hospital for help as well. Mr. Speaker, the bottom line is, however people choose to do so, they can reach out for help. They can and should reach out for help as soon as they can. No one should feel like he or she has nowhere to turn. And no one should have to go through what the Parsons family is right now. Mr. Speaker, this is a time to be kind to one another and to care for each other. We need to keep caring about these problems in the days, weeks, and months ahead. We need to channel our sorrow and frustration into positive change. Mr. Speaker, I would like to thank Nova Scotians for supporting Rattaya's family and respecting their privacy during this very difficult time. They are in our hearts and minds as we build a plan forward and help each other through this. Rattaya's mother has been very public on her daughter's death, more so than anyone could have ever expected of a grieving mother. In her comments, she has a very important message for Nova Scotians. More violence is not the answer. Justice is to be done in the justice system. The family has asked that I today implore Nova Scotians not to take matters into their own hands. That is what Rattaya would have wanted. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
The Honourable Leader of the Official Opposition.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I want to, first of all, associate myself with the remarks of the Premier. Extend my condolences to the Parsons family. I think all of us in this House have family. Cannot begin to imagine what the Parson family is going through. It's to try to imagine what the experience that Rattaya has had gone through over the last number of years is just unimaginable. It saddens me, though, I must say, that in the province of Nova Scotia, so rich in so many ways, that young people like Rattaya feel no support and no hope. With all that we have to offer as a society, that our children get to the point where there's no one left to turn to but the tragic consequences that Rattaya resorted to. Mr. Speaker, today we're talking about Rattaya. There are, unfortunately, other families who are grieving as well for their loved ones who have taken the same act, feeling that there was no one to turn to, no public institution, no person in the community, no society, no one in society that was there to support them. I can't tell you how saddened as a father I am to believe that that young people today feel that way. You know, we need to come to terms with, as much as things change, we need to rapidly change ourselves to deal with the changing in telecommunications, the change to the way young people respond to one another. And we need to do it in a very quick and forceful way. I'm pleased that the Premier has appointed the Minister, Minister Moore, to head this task force. I want to say to the Minister, as the leader of this party, I'm prepared to participate in any way I can that puts in place strong consequences for the kind of actions that have been allowed to go out for too long in the province, to put in place strong protocols so that young Nova Scotians who find themselves in the same position that Rattaya was in, that they know there are other options for them. I'm prepared to participate in a place that's putting in strong resources for families who find themselves at the end of the rope with no hope of trying to deal with these issues. We're here to do whatever we can to ensure that the next Nova Scotia family that finds themselves with a young person being forced into this kind of situation, that we're there to help them to the best of our ability. Mr. Speaker, I too want to echo with the Premier again today to other Nova Scotians. We have a justice system. For all of its flaws and faults may be, it is the appropriate place that the entire consequences around this should be dealt with. I think all members of the Scotia send a strong message and implore to all Nova Scotians to allow the justice system to do its work, to make sure that whatever consequences can come out of this, that are done in a lawful way, in a meaningful way. There's one family suffering today. The last thing we as a province need to do is add more grief and suffering to what is already a tragic event. So, Mr. Speaker, with that, I want to offer again to the Minister my personal support in any way that I can work with you to make sure that we have meaningful action on this file. And to the Premier again, I want to again offer my support in any way we can as a party to make sure that we have meaningful results for young Nova Scotians.
The Honourable Leader of the Progressive Conservative Party.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Let me begin by saying that on behalf of the PC Party, we do reach our hands across the aisle to the government side to work together on the consequences of the tragedy that Nova Scotians all share in grieving here today. To the Premier and to the Minister he has assigned, they have our full cooperation and full support as they go about doing their job in government of dealing with this horrible situation. Mr. Speaker, Nova Scotia has gained national and international attention over the last few days as the story of Rattaya Parsons has echoed around the world. It's not a way that any of us in this House, regardless of our political stripe, would wish for Nova Scotia to make national and international news. Perhaps by coming together, we can continue to make national news by turning the province's problem around, by truly being leaders in the country when it comes to protecting our young people, when it comes to the consequences of bullying and cyberbullying. Perhaps Nova Scotia will now take what has come our way and turn it into something that can truly be a position of leadership for our country as we deal with the modern consequences of bullying and cyberbullying and the activities that surround this horrible tragedy. I know, Mr. Speaker, that many, if not all of us in this House, in addition to being politicians, are also moms and dads, grandfathers and grandmothers, and so we are all affected, like all other Nova Scotians are, in a very personal way. I had this very talk with my own two daughters last night at bedtime and again this morning as they see the front page of the Halifax Herald and they see the evening news. This is a discussion that's going on in my house about what can be done to protect people in the future who were in the circumstances of Rataya Parsons. And I believe it's a discussion that's going on in every household, by every mom and dad with their own kids. And Mr. Speaker, in addition to being moms and dads, we are charged with the responsibility of being legislators. And so I hope that we now have those very same household discussions here in this House on behalf of the entire household of Nova Scotia, as we are responsible to do. And I do want the Premier and the Minister to know that as we do that, we will be working together and they will have our support, because it is so sad, as we are all sad, this great Nova Scotia family, we are all sad that the young woman felt she had no place to turn. And we do have a responsibility today to point out to all of the young children of Nova Scotia, teenagers and otherwise, that there is always a choice. There is always hope. There is always a place to turn, whether it's a helpline or a mental health services or to a school official or to your own parents. Let every child in Nova Scotia know they always have some place to go for help. And where there are holes in the system that this tragedy uncovers, let's plug those holes so we can truly say to a whole new generation of young Nova Scotians, there is always a choice, and we will help you make it, and we will keep you safe, and we will help you back to a healthier place. That is how Nova Scotia can become a true leader and make news in a more positive way in the future. And so I say to the Minister, good luck and Godspeed in your new duties. You have our full support. We will provide you with anything that we have, ideas around earlier interventions or more of the recommendations of the task force report that we can accelerate and get into place faster. That is something that we can do not only as parents in this House, but as legislators. And so, Mr. Speaker, through you and to all members of the House and to all Nova Scotians, let's tell all of our children that there's always a place to turn, there's always hope, and we will make sure that that is more true in Nova Scotia than ever before. And that may well be exactly what Rataya Parsons wants us to do. So thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Government notices of motion. The Honourable Minister of Fisheries and Agriculture.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Before I read my resolution, may I be permitted an introduction?
Well, certainly.
I want to direct members of the House to the East Gallery, and today joining us is Mr. Grin Jones, Senior Director of Ducks Unlimited Canada for Newfoundland and Labrador, Nova Scotia. And I ask the members to give a warm welcome to Mr. Jones.
We welcome all our guests to the gallery and hope that they enjoy this afternoon's proceedings. I will now recognize the Honourable Minister of Fisheries and Aquaculture.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I hereby give notice on the future day I should move the adoption of the following resolution. Whereas Ducks Unlimited Canada, a national and international organization with deep roots in this province, is celebrating its 75th anniversary this year. And whereas Ducks Unlimited Canada's members across Nova Scotia work hard to preserve the habitat of numerous waterfowl, animals, and native plants, some of which are protected or endangered. And whereas Ducks Unlimited Canada's efforts benefits all Nova Scotians by moderating the efforts of floods, droughts, climate change, and erosions, while helping to provide safe, clean sources of water. Therefore, be it resolved that the members of this House of Assembly congratulate Ducks Unlimited Canada, and especially all of those in Nova Scotia's members, in this their 75th year, and offer our heartfelt thanks for their selfless work to maintain wetlands, wildlife habitats across Nova Scotia to preserve our natural heritage for future generations. Mr. Speaker, request waiver of notice and passage without debate.
There has been a request for waiver. Is it agreed?
Agreed.
All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
All those against say nay. Motion is carried. Introduction of bills. The Honourable Leader of the Progressive Conservative Party.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I beg leave to introduce a bill entitled An Act to Amend Chapter 475 of the Revised Statutes 1989, the Trade Union Act, respecting first contract arbitration.
The Honourable Leader of the Progressive Conservative Party begs leave to introduce a bill entitled An Act to Amend Chapter 475 of the Revised Statutes 1989, the Trade Union Act, respecting first contract arbitration.
Bill number 38, entitled An Act to Amend Chapter 475 of the Revised Statutes 1989, the Trade Union Act, respecting first contract arbitration.
Order that the bill be read a second time on a future day. I will now recognize the Honourable Leader of the Progressive Conservative Party.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I beg leave to introduce a bill entitled An Act to Amend Chapter 475 of the Revised Statutes 1989, the Trade Union Act, to protect users of accessible transit services.
The Honourable Leader of the Progressive Conservative Party begs leave to introduce a bill entitled An Act to Amend Chapter 475 of the Revised Statutes 1989, the Trade Union Act, to protect users of accessible transit services.
Bill number 39, entitled An Act to Amend Chapter 475 of the Revised Statutes 1989, the Trade Union Act, to protect users of accessible transit services.
Order that the bill be read a second time on a future day. Notices of motion. Orders of the day, oral questions put by members to ministers. The time is now 12:33. We will finish at 1:33. And I will now recognize the Honourable Leader of the Official Opposition.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, the Minister of Education met with school boards on February 14th of this year to give boards their funding targets. Five boards were told they would see funding cuts of nearly $5 million in total. This is, of course, on top of the $31 million that was cut in funding, Mr. Speaker, and a $34 million in inflationary costs that the government has downloaded onto boards. So my question to the Premier, can the Premier tell parents, students, and teachers how much money his government has cut out of public education in the last 3.5 years?
Honourable the Premier.
Mr. Speaker, what we have done is increase the amount of per student funding in education now to its highest levels in history. We have, of course, gone through some very, very difficult times in this province where there simply is not the money available to do what was done in the past. So we have sought to work with the boards in order to ensure that their funding is appropriate to be able to deliver the services that the young people of our province need and deserve. And we intend to continue to do that. We ask them, and I know that the boards have worked away at taking that money out of administration so that it would not come out of the classroom. We would like to, of course, encourage them to continue to engage in that kind of appropriate budgeting.
The Honourable Leader of the Official Opposition on his first supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, I don't know of a board in the province of Nova Scotia that feels like the province that the government has actually been working with them in the best interest of kids, Mr. Speaker. Since taking office, Mr. Speaker, the Premier has seen $76 million cuts in public education. Over 700 teacher positions have been cut, thanks to this government, and another 170 being cut in this budget cycle alone. Schools are going without maintenance work, and young children are having to spend hours
to get to and from school. On the flip side, Mr. Speaker, the cost of power has gone up 30% under this government, and school boards have reported power bills $1 million, Mr. Speaker. $1 million in power bills alone, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, will the Premier tell those parents and teachers what he expects boards to eliminate because of this direct funding cut to school boards? More teachers, student supports, maintenance, buses, which one?
The Honourable the Premier.
Mr. Speaker, I just want to correct the information from the Leader of the Opposition. No teachers have been cut from our system. In fact, Mr. Speaker, we are adding in more teachers as a result of increased funding where they are needed. We have instituted class caps on class size to ensure that and hired more teachers in order to make sure that that has happened. In addition to that, Mr. Speaker, we are building new schools in communities throughout the province, Mr. Speaker. We are providing Nova Scotia students with the best quality of education. We are working with our partners to ensure that takes place. We are doing that under one of the most financially challenging periods in our province's history. But the good news, Mr. Speaker, as evidenced by the budget this year, is that we're turning the corner. There is, in fact, because of the good financial management of the province, there is now more opportunity for us to be able to extend services, and we intend to do that.
The Honourable Leader of the Official Opposition on his final supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, it's very clear what we've seen under this government is a direct attack on public education, Mr. Speaker.
Neil.
This government has tried to balance the books on the backs of our children, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, there are 700 teaching positions that have been eliminated since this government has taken power. Mr. Speaker, and then when school boards go about doing what is their responsibility when it comes to looking at their infrastructure, when they look at whether or not to close schools, Mr. Speaker, they go through the gut-wrenching experience of asking parents, teachers, and community members to come forward to make a concrete decision about what they can do. This minister interferes in that decision, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, but not only, Mr. Speaker, does the minister interfere, Mr. Speaker, she interferes but says no new money, Mr. Speaker. So I want to say directly to the Premier, Mr. Speaker, when the South Shore Regional School Board is being forced to keep open the Gold River Western Shore Elementary School that requires a $100,000 new roof, where does he expect that board to get the money? Is he prepared to pay that bill?
Yeah. Honourable the Premier.
Mr. Speaker, the question that was asked by the Leader of the Opposition contains inherent contradictions, and I know that they're happy with that. But the reality is that this is a leader who told his own annual general meeting that he was happy with the engagement that had taken place, that he thought the model actually worked, despite the fact that it has been community dividing, adversarial, despite the fact that communities across the province have said that this is not the manner in which they want to handle this. And further, Mr. Speaker, he talks about the idea of interfering in a process when you have a minister which is actually listening to the people of the province about the concerns that they have, and who is going to the boards to say, in the context of the decisions that you're being asked to make, would you delay these decisions so that we might work with you in order to develop a better process, one that has a better process for bringing communities together rather than dividing them, Mr. Speaker. I don't see that as interference. I see that as responsibility.
Order, please. I am about to break a long-standing tradition about introductions and question periods. I feel that it's necessary. We have a very important dignitary that's joined us here today, so I will now recognize the Honourable Leader of the Progressive Conservative Party to do the introduction, but I will add a minute to question period.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. It is my great honour as Leader of the Progressive Conservative Party to introduce to the House the 21st Premier of Nova Scotia a man whose wisdom all Nova Scotians remember and still refer to his snippets of wisdom as bacon bits, the Honourable Roger Baker. Baker.
Thank you. We welcome all our guests to the gallery and hope that they enjoy this afternoon's proceedings. I will now recognize the Honourable Leader of the Progressive Conservative Party on his question.
Thank you. Mr. Speaker, my question to the Premier is this. Nova Scotia is, as we discussed, making national and international news this week for very sad and tragic reasons. But together we now do have a moment where we can truly make news in a more positive way by being a leader in the prevention of bullying and cyberbullying here at home and show the rest of the country how to do that. One of the recommendations of the McKay Task Force on bullying, Mr. Speaker, was to teach a digital citizenship in our schools, to actually place it on the curriculum so that all young Nova Scotians know both the rights and the responsibilities that they now have as citizens in an online and digital world, that they can use those tools for the good that they are meant to be and learn not to use those tools in a destructive manner. And so my question to the Premier is, will he agree to place digital citizenship on the school curriculum as soon as possible, as recommended by the report? And I'll table that page of the report for the Premier.
Honourable the Premier.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. This recommendation, of course, was accepted by the government and, in fact, is embedded within the curriculum of the schools and, in fact, starts, as I understand it, in grade primary.
The Honourable Leader of the Progressive Conservative Party on his first supplementary.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I thank the Premier for that answer. Mr. Speaker, the government has not incorporated all of the recommendations of the McKay Task Force, even though it was the result of over a year of consultation and discussion with both experts and those that are involved in protecting our children. For example, the task force did provide a definition of cyberbullying that could be placed into provincial law to ensure that those that engage in bullying and cyberbullying know both what it is and the consequences of committing that offence. And so I will ask the Premier, will he now commit to defining cyberbullying as an offence in provincial law, including spelling out the consequences for those that engage in it?
Honourable the Premier.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Of course, we have looked carefully. We have implemented those recommendations in the task force that we felt were capable of being implemented, those that we considered needed more study. That is certainly underway. Certainly the committee will have the opportunity to go back and revisit that report. And we intend to move forward very, very quickly. As the leader of the Conservative Party would know, we Nova Scotia, in fact, up until this point, has been a leader with respect to bullying. We are the ones who had the first bullying task force, and we move forward accepting the fact that the system technology is constantly changing, which means that we have a responsibility to continue to modify, continue to learn what the consequences of these technologies are, and to do something about it. And that is the commitment that the government has.
Honourable Leader of the Progressive Conservative Party on his final supplementary.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and again I thank the Premier for that answer. The need to implement all of the recommendations of the McKay Task Force is now stronger than ever, and so I would encourage the government to not merely study the study any longer, but get on with reviewing all of the recommendations and putting them into practice, Mr. Speaker. As I will ask the Premier as a result, the McKay Task Force included some recommendations around giving school officials and other responsible figures of authority all the tools they need for a greater early intervention when they see bullying or cyberbullying taking place, to give them the tools to actually intervene in time to stop it in its tracks. So, Mr. Speaker, I ask the Premier, will he commit to implementing all of the recommendations of the McKay Task Force, including those that specifically address early intervention tools?
Honourable the Premier.
Well, Mr. Speaker, I want him to know that the recommendations that have been accepted have all been implemented, including the one that he mentions. The fact of the matter is that the teachers have had in-service in order to be made aware of the supports that are available. This has been part of rolling out the the information they need in order to be able to support students who they may identify as having difficulty. The leader of the Conservative Party may also know that with respect to these matters, that many of those recommendations would have to involve the federal government, the areas of jurisdiction that belong wholly or partly to the federal government. And I, for one, completely agree this is something that should demand. Nova Scotia is a small jurisdiction. We are a caring jurisdiction with respect to our citizens. But there are some matters, there are some areas of work that needs to be done that really extends beyond the boundaries of our province. And so there needs to be attention paid to this by the House of Parliament, and of course we will work with them, not only give them the benefit of the work that we've already done, but to assist them in any way we might to address the issues that we now find before our House.
The Honourable Member for Colchester North.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, yesterday the Minister of Education made her early years announcement. Sadly, nobody was surprised when we soon realized it was more hype than substance. But keep tuned in, there'll be more to come. A brief issued yesterday at the announcement notes that early years centres, wherever they will be, whenever they will be established, will work with early intervention programs. So my question to the minister is this. Can the Minister of Education tell members of this House today how much government currently spends on early intervention programs?
Minister of Education and Early Childhood Development.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. We're in transition with our new early years department, and the information about the early intervention is moving over from the Department of Community Services, so I won't be able to answer that because that's not over in my department at this time. Thank you.
The Honourable Member for Colchester North.
Well, thank you, Mr. Speaker. Well, I will tell the House. $2.9 million is currently being spent on early intervention, so perhaps the minister could check that out. There are 900 families already getting support from 17 agencies, but those agencies are maxed out. In fact, on top of supporting families and facing growing wait lists, early intervention programs have to fundraise as part of their service agreements. But, Mr. Speaker, children are aging out of the program while they're waiting for service because this government has not funded them properly. So my question to the minister is this. How can the minister expect that parents will believe early years are a priority for her government when they can't even yet properly fund the services that are in place?
The Honourable Minister of Education and Early Childhood Development.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker, and I know that parents and stakeholders across the province were very excited with the announcement yesterday of the integration of all the aspects of early years being under one roof, and so I look forward to working with the stakeholders and with our communities as we integrate our service to meet the needs of our youngest citizens. Thank you.
The Honourable Member for Colchester North on her final supplementary.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, parents and those who were at the announcement have a right to feel concerned when this minister says that something is her priority. For example, she said cyberbullying plan was a priority, and we know what happened to that. She's putting impossible demands on school boards to choose operations over programming while she guts their funding. She's her cuts to education will begin when students are continuing to wait for speech language and school psych ed assessments. So, Mr. Speaker, my question to the minister, why should parents believe this minister is making education and early education a priority when she consistently lets children and families down?
The Honourable Minister of Education and Early Childhood Development.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. I'm very proud to stand here that as a government, we are addressing areas that the other government was unable to address. I know that we have taken the issue of bullying and cyberbullying as a task force, and we are the government that have went out and we've consulted with Nova Scotians. We've been out in focus groups all across the province with our early years. This government is addressing the needs of our youngest citizens and addressing the needs of our students across this province. Thank you.
The Honourable Member for King's West.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, over the past couple of days, Nova Scotians have been flooded with a set of announcements which produced lots of photo ops but were light on details. Proof in point, the insulin pump announcement, which is a good announcement. Instead of providing specifics, we got a press release which reads, and I quote, "The province expects to begin taking applications by July 31st. I will table that release." Mr. Speaker, that sentence doesn't instill much confidence, given the press release was issued by the Premier's office. Could the Minister of Health and Wellness please confirm whether applications will be available and accepted by July 31st, yes or no?
The Honourable Minister of Health and Wellness.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I appreciate the member being at one of those photo ops with the Premier and I. I know he's very interested in the insulin pump program, Mr. Speaker, and I look forward to the member approving and supporting the budget so we can move forward to implementing this service.
The Honourable Member for King's West on his first supplementary.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. This caucus is happy this government came to its senses, funded insulin pumps, although it should have happened 4 years ago. While Tuesday's announcement spoke about taking applications, it was silent on when the insulin pump program will be up and running. Could the minister please tell us how long applicants will have to wait for their insulin pumps once applications are accepted, which may or may not happen by July 31st?
The Honourable Minister of Health and Wellness.
Thank you. Mr. Speaker. Children's health care is very important to this government, Mr. Speaker. That's why we are reinstating a program cut by the Liberals under the dental care for children, Mr. Speaker. That's why we're introducing an insulin pump program here in Nova Scotia, Mr. Speaker. I know the young people that were in attendance of the event the other day are extremely happy, Mr. Speaker. We're going to work as quickly as we can to ensure that we pass the budget and that we implement the program as soon as we can. And I know Nova Scotians are looking forward to that program to be up and running here in the province, Mr. Speaker.
The Honourable Member for Inverness.
Mr. Speaker, we are all mourning the death of Retea Parsons. I know in Inverness, I've had many calls and emails from people in Inverness County who are feeling terrible about the situation. The minister said yesterday that he would consider strengthening legislation around the distribution of disturbing graphic images. This is an important step. May I also suggest we have a need for laws that allow for early intervention. My question for the Minister of Justice, will the minister give school officials and others in positions of authority the necessary tools, such as having the ability to remove cell phones, to allow for early intervention on bullying?
The Honourable Minister of Justice.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I want to thank the member for his question. And I just want to further the Minister's statement, the Premier's statement earlier this afternoon, regards to the strategy that we're putting forth
with my colleague in the House, the Minister responsible for the status of women, who will have responsibility over putting a collective voice from a cross-section of all Nova Scotians to look at how we best address this. I also want to point out to my colleague there that I've written to my federal colleague, the Honourable Robert Nicholson, in Ottawa, and expressed my concern to help expedite some of the work that we have been doing in regards to this matter, and I've asked him if I could meet with him on an urgent basis in regards to this, and I'll table this letter for a matter of record. I just want to point out to all Nova Scotians that the issue of bullying is something that I personally take to heart in a commitment, and that I, as the minister responsible for justice, am fully committed to this, and we as a government are as well.
The Honourable Member for Inverness on his first supplementary.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I've met the federal minister myself, and I know he's been a champion for victims of crime, so I'm sure he'll be taking you up on that. Mr. Speaker, we need to allow our legal system and our schools to have the tool of early intervention so that these situations don't escalate to such devastating degrees. The McKay report recommended we adopt a model similar to that of the Domestic Violence Intervention Act. My question for the minister, will the minister make intervention a priority to guide our young people away from hurting others?
The Honourable Minister of Justice.
Thank you. I want to thank the member again for that question. Absolutely. I'm committed. Our government's committed. And it's a matter of getting education for our young people to be aware of the respect for one another, to know the boundaries, what's appropriate, what's inappropriate, but as well to deal with the cultural lag that's occurring in our society where technology is moving faster than the culture can adapt. And what I mean by that is that the technology out there, that the consequences of our pictures and the impact that that has and the awareness. And so the education that we need to do needs to be extended, and we're fully behind that. And that's why, once again, I'll reiterate the strategy today to put a minister responsible to focus that energy and to take that collective voice to try and make a positive difference in our province, to not have a repeat of what's occurred this week.
The Honourable Member for Inverness on his final supplementary.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And there's no question bullying has been with us since the dawn of man, no doubt. And certainly it has taken on a new face with, and the member has corrected me rightly so, the dawn of men and women. But my point being that, as an agreement with the minister, that technology has put a whole new reality around bullying. And I think the minister has answered my question favorably, and I thank him for that. The point being that if people in schools and public places where young people are, when they're away from their parents and their homes, have the ability to use measures to remove those electronic tools when they're being used to bully others, I think that is a good thing. So, Minister, I think if we're in agreement here, I'm going to avoid asking a second supplementary and allow the Speaker to carry on with question period. Thank you.
The Honourable Member for Richmond.
Mr. Speaker, the Department of Transportation Infrastructure Renewal earlier this year issued tenders for aggregate to carry out single chip seal paving in the counties of Richmond, Inverness, and Victoria. That work was to be carried out this summer. Mr. Speaker, this week on Monday, April the 8th, these three tenders were abruptly cancelled by the Department of Transportation and Infrastructure Renewal. Speaker, bidders on the tenders were given no notice of a change prior to Monday's announcement. A lot of work and effort goes into preparing these bids, and private businesses in the counties of Richmond, Inverness, and Victoria were looking forward to some much-needed work for local truckers. My question is, will the Minister of Transportation and Infrastructure Renewal advise the House as to why these three tenders were cancelled so abruptly?
The Honourable Minister of Transportation Infrastructure Renewal.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I thank my friend for the question. Yes, as in any process that we undertake, there's a procurement policy that we follow. And tendering is the way we go. In this particular case, the tenders were issued. And when they were returned, they were significantly higher than what our anticipation was for that project. And for what the budget was we were considering would be appropriate for that project. So we have canceled those tenders and are trying to find ways of providing the aggregate needed in another fashion. Now, I can tell my friend opposite that our intent is to fully complete the work that we had indicated we were going to undertake in Cape Breton this summer, and that will happen. Thank you.
The Honourable Member for Richmond on his first supplementary.
Well, Mr. Speaker, we're pleased to see the work is going to be carried out, but the question becomes, how is the department going to get this aggregate if it's not going to a tendering process? The Minister has indicated that they've respected the tendering process and that's how they operate, but now that you've cancelled the tenders, how is it that the department is going to move forward in obtaining this aggregate if the tender process has been cancelled? So basically my question to the minister is the minister stating today that they will be obtaining this aggregate by picking and choosing who they want rather than respecting the long-standing tendering process that's been in place?
The Honourable Minister of Transportation Infrastructure Renewal.
Thank you. I thank the member for the question. In this particular case, we will be, as I said, I can assure the member opposite that the appropriate measures will be taken to assure that the work that we have scheduled in Cape Breton will be going forward. I actually met this week with the members from the Road Builders Association. They raised that issue with me. We explained to them what the situation was, why the tenders were cancelled at this particular time. They understood the need for us to be careful in terms of the monies we spend and to look at whatever options we can come up with in order to provide the materials necessary to get the job done. And at this stage, that's what we're doing. If we can come up with a method that's going to provide us with the aggregate at a more reasonable price than the tenders provided, then that's the route we will go. Obviously, if there isn't a source that's going to provide us to that for us, then we will be back looking at those tenders again. Thank you.
The Honourable Member for Richmond on his final supplementary.
Well, Mr. Speaker, I'm not sure what message this sends to all the bidders out there as to the work that they put into the tendering process. If the minister can simply turn around and say the tenders are too high, we're just going to go and buy it from where we can find it cheaper. Why do we have a tendering process in the province to start off with? And I know that the minister is looking to find as cheap as possible, and the government has somehow painted the road builders as big bad wolves here, but let's keep in mind that there are also local truckers, small independent businesses that were relying on this work from the larger road builders that are now out of work. So I guess my question is, if the minister is going to go and cherry pick who he's going to buy the aggregate from, will the minister indicate whether local road truckers are going to have the opportunity to be part of this work, or is it all going to be carried out by whoever they buy the aggregate from that they've handpicked?
The Honourable Minister of Transportation Infrastructure Renewal.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And again, I'll tell my friend that as much as possible, of course, because it's an advantage to us to use local trucking because of the distances involved and that kind of thing. So as much as possible, yes, we will be using local truckers to haul the aggregate when we get it to where the site is going to be. My understanding is that there will be a number of dumps in the area that the aggregate will be placed, obviously as close as possible to the work that is going to be done, but local truckers certainly will be involved in moving it from those sites to where it needs to go. Thank you.
The Honourable Member for Victoria the Lakes.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, yesterday the Minister of Education and Early Childhood Development avoided answering my question about our government's future plans for funding private and non-profit child care centres. I've now stood in this House and presented 9 examples of the NDP saying one thing and then another on the issue. So my question once again, Mr. Speaker, through you, will the Minister finally tell members of this House if her department is reviewing the funding model for child care centres?
The Honourable Minister of Education and Early Childhood Development.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. I'm really looking forward to working with the, we're developing a provincial early years partnership, and I'm really looking forward to working with our stakeholders in this area, because there's been a lot of studies done over the last number of years, and there's many issues that, we need to work together and move forward with. Thank you.
The Honourable Member for Victoria de Lakes on his first supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, the government has changed its tune on this issue 9 times in 16 months. They continue to keep parents and small business owners guessing. The government's plan will have impact on hundreds of small business owners and thousands of families. People deserve to know what the NDP plans to do. Mr. Speaker, I tabled for the minister yesterday the Hansard from the Standing Committee on Community Services, where the Deputy Minister of Community Services said there was no plans to review the funding model. Yesterday, the minister told reporters there was, and I had the news article to prove that, and I'll table it, Mr. Speaker. So my question through you to the minister, what childcare funding changes will the government be making?
Good question. The Honourable Minister of Education and Early Childhood Development.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. I am very pleased to say that the Nova Scotia Child Care Association were at the announcement on yesterday, and they are very pleased with our announcement. And the person that's in charge of that, Ms. Couture, who I met for the first time yesterday, Caitlin Couture, agreed with the minister, stating that the good work that is happening already in the delivery of childcare, building on that, addressing gaps as identified, was a positive approach. Thank you very much. And I will take over.
The Honourable Member for Victoria Lakes on his final supplementary.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. But the group also says at that same article that I presented that the devil is in the details, so I guess we have to wait longer for that. Mr. Speaker, there are communities across this province with only one childcare facility. In many cases, that childcare centre is run by a small business owner. The government cannot continue to be so secretive about what their decisions will mean to Nova Scotians. Nova Scotians need answers, and they deserve an apology. So my question through you to the minister, why does the minister continue to veil her government's intentions and speak out of both sides of her mouth?
The Honourable Minister of Education and Early Childhood Development.
Mr. Speaker, thank you very much. And I would like to just say that in all of my delivery, I always try to be as respectful as possible to every member in this chamber. And I would like to say that I'm a bit offended by the comment that was made, and I would like to stand on record that there's no need for us to, considering the situation we're dealing with in terms of bullying in this province, but I would like to say that I am offended. I will answer the question, though, Mr. Speaker, because I see what I would like to say that coming from the release from the Nova Scotia Child Care Association, that they're looking forward to applying the wealth of expertise and experience that they have in planning and delivering and sustaining quality in early learning and child care services available. There, we're working together as we move through this process. Again, Mr. Speaker, thank you very much.
The Honourable Member for Richmond.
Mr. Speaker, Strait Area Transit provides an essential transportation system for residents in the town of Port Hawkesbury and the counties of Richmond and Inverness. On March 25th, Strait Area Transit suspended its operations due to financial concerns. Mr. Speaker, it's now been over 2 weeks that this service has not been in operation. People have had to cancel medical appointments and miss other appointments as well because of the suspension of the service. Could the Minister of Service Nova Scotia and Municipal Relations advise the House as to what the status is of negotiations to resume the operations of Strait Area Transit?
The Honourable Minister of Service Nova Scotia and Municipal Relations.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And I think when the member asked a question on this topic a couple of weeks back, I indicated that my staff were intending and trying to set up a meeting with stakeholders in the area, which Ramona included the representatives from the municipalities involved. So that meeting happened yesterday, Mr. Speaker, and I haven't yet been been briefed as to the outcome of that. I want the members to know, and the member opposite for sure, that my staff did go with a proposal, around what we could offer from the province in terms of funding, and I want the this would be short term in the hopes that they would get to a long term solution. The issue around people's appointments and whatever. We also fund the straight area transit money through a door-to-door program, which is actually the way we fund other transit associations in the province. We don't fund fixed route, but because straight area has a combination of the two, so I think it would be up to them to try to ensure that because we fund the door-to-door so people can get to their appointments, that would be an aspect of their program that they see to it that they maintain. Thank you.
The Honourable Member for Richmond on his first supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, I can't encourage the Minister enough to look at this as an emergency situation. When you've got people missing important medical appointments because of this loss of service, you have students that attend the Regional Occupation Center in Port Hawkesbury that are being disrupted as well. People came to rely upon this service, and I know the government has indicated how it sees this as an important service. So I would hope that the minister would see this as an emergency situation and be prepared to put the funding necessary in place while a long-term solution is being carried out, because as we talk about this, we have riders that do not have a means of transportation, and that needs to be addressed. So my question to the minister again is he prepared to put in place emergency funding to get straight area transit up and running as soon as possible?
The Honourable Minister of Service Nova Scotia and Municipal Relations.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Well, that was the game plan that my staff went down there with. It was the idea that we would use our envelope of funding that we have to help them in the short term until a long-term solution could happen. I think the member is aware that the province gave $120,000 last fall and another $5,000 a couple of weeks back, and we were not informed about the impending shutdown of service. We do not fund fixed route transit, Mr. Speaker, and it's my expectation that we will not be funding this into the long term. Thank you.
The Honourable Member for Richmond on his final supplementary.
Well, Mr. Speaker, I'm sure that the residents of Strait Area listening to that are a bit confused about door-to-door and fixed route and funding. So let me make the answer as simple as possible, and hopefully the minister can make his answer as simple as possible. How much money is the minister and his department prepared to make available to Strait Area Transit today to restore that service?
The Honourable Minister of Service Nova Scotia and Municipal Relations.
Thank you. I can get that. I can get that number probably for the member before the end of the day. It would be what is in the envelope for that programs that we traditionally offer, and the reason for the meeting with the stakeholders, and in particular the municipalities, is that fixed transit is funded through municipal units and not through the province, Mr. Speaker.
The Honourable Member for Argyle.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. It's good to stand and ask this question once again. Over the last number of sessions, I've pretty much asked this question almost every time to the Minister of Economic Development. The issue of the remaining creditors from the fallout of the closing of the Southwest Shore Development Authority. As you know, a beautiful school community centre was constructed in the village of Tuskett, a great model of rural development that's well used by Acadian community. A place to gather, a place to celebrate and maintain our distinct culture and heritage. But a cloud still hangs over the remaining $400,000 that is owed to the local contractor, Garing Construction. Will the minister review this once again and help find a solution once and for all in order to get Garing Construction paid?
The Honourable Minister of Economic and Rural Development and Tourism.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And I thank the member for the question. And first of all, I've got to say is that as an entrepreneur myself, been in business for 23 plus years, is that when you're owed money, you like to be paid. And I know that as an entrepreneur and as an individual, and I'm sure that there are many members of the House have seen in our days some debts that weren't paid, money owing to us. And one of the problems we have with this case, this instance, is that monies were paid out by the provincial government to take care of that debt. And certainly I agree with the member opposite, a nice facility, a great facility down there. And we did fill our obligation when we were asked by SWASDA to look after that debt, and we did that by writing the check.
For Argyle on his first supplementary.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker, and thank the minister for that answer. Even though, really, when you look at it, I'm not asking that the minister go and write another check to try to pay for this. What I'm asking for him to do is to sit down with the local councils, maybe with some local business people, and sit down with Guerin Construction to see if there's a solution that can be found. Many times we've heard that maybe litigation is the only way to go on this, but the difficulty we had all along with Guerin Construction, the school community center, is the fact that it is a Crown-owned property. It is attached to a school, and therefore a lien couldn't be put on it and be very difficult to litigate that way. So again, my question to the minister is, will the minister listen to the pleas of local area and Guerin Construction and commit to finding a solution?
The Honourable Minister of Economic and Rural Development and Tourism.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I said yesterday, I proclaimed that I'm one of the most accessible ministers in government, and I will reiterate that when it comes to accessibility, that I'm very accommodating. And you know, I've had a very recent meeting with the with Mayor Mood. I do know that there's another meeting that's planned in the weeks ahead with the mayor, with the warden. That I will be at. It will be at the premier's office, and I pretty well know the agenda in advance, and again, I think in a case like this, Mr. Speaker, I think we've demonstrated our willingness to meet with the good people of Yarmouth, and we will continue to demonstrate that.
The Honourable Member for Halifax Clayton Park.
Thank you. Mr. Speaker, my question is for the Minister responsible for immigration. Mr. Speaker, in the 2012-13 Statement of Mandate, the Office of Immigration set a target of 2,600 permanent residents to the province of Nova Scotia. Preliminary data from Citizenship and Immigration show we welcomed 2,370 permanent residents to Nova Scotia in 2012, which is short of the government's target that was set so recently. What's worse, Mr. Speaker, is that since this NDP government assumed power, we saw year-over-year decreases of new immigrants to our province to the tune of 8.6%, 1%, and 11.2%, respectively. And, Mr. Speaker, I'd be happy to table that chart just so that the rest of the members can see it as well. My question for the minister responsible for immigration is, would the minister please tell us why this NDP government, despite touting a brand new immigration strategy, is failing to meet the target that they have set for themselves?
The Honourable the Deputy Premier.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, au contraire. We have exceeded targets, Mr. Speaker, and to that point, we have, through the diligent work of the Premier, got it up to 700, Mr. Speaker. So, you know, we are working with immigrants coming into the province, Mr. Speaker. We are working closely with our federal counterparts in building our profile within the immigrant community and building that up, and it's a work in progress, and we're moving forward with it. Thank you.
The Honourable Member for Halifax Clayton Park on her first supplementary.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I'm referring to the total number of immigrants. I think the minister is referring to the nominee numbers that were allowed, and the 200 he speaks to are for 1 year only. We were given an extra $200 to increase, so that's not a permanent increase, which again is unfortunate to meeting any of the goals that are outlined in the immigration strategy. The government has cut the international graduate stream, they cut the agri-food pilot stream, and the non-dependent child stream has also been cut, all because, according to a 2012 Chronicle Herald story, the federal government was irked that these streams existed and perhaps duplicated. I'll table that as well, Mr. Speaker, for the minister's benefit. Mr. Speaker, we're seeing more and more of this government ceding its own provincial responsibility to the Harper Conservatives, and, Mr. Speaker, no good will ever come of that. But absolutely. But that's not all we see cut. We see cuts as well. There's also been a cut to the immigration budget this year. Could the minister please indicate whether the cut in the budget, in addition to our cuts in the provincial nominee streams, is an admission that the NDP government has failed when it comes to immigration?
The Honourable Deputy Premier.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I'm chuckling, but this is a serious matter. Speaker, you know, one thing this government has done is in a very positive way, is look at our record on retention, Mr. Speaker, where it's really at. That's what it is. We're retaining more immigrants than ever before, Mr. Speaker. And indeed, the one thing that that questioner came awful close to me in agreement is that the cuts have happened. But the cuts are kind of beside her there. It's the federal government that's doing the cuts, not the province. Thank you.
The Honourable Member for Halifax, Clayton Park, on her final supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, the fact of the matter is that the NDP government have ceded parts of our provincial nominee program to the Harper Conservatives, and then they're using this uploading to justify a budget cut. We all agree that in this House that immigration is important, and I think we can all agree that this NDP government has failed in their aims in immigration. Mr. Speaker, it's interesting to note that this NDP government has tied its immigration strategy to its failed Jobs Here strategy, which speaks volumes. Mr. Speaker, given that we need to increase the number of permanent residents by over 50% in the next 2 years in order to meet the goals that are set out in the immigration strategy, how will this, would the minister please tell us how this target will ever be achieved?
Honourable the Deputy Premier.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, again, with all due respect to the member, she's confusing federal responsibilities and provincial responsibilities, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, we are doing a tremendous job in attracting and retaining. And, Mr. Speaker, the member has only look in her own constituency. I would say it's probably one of the most diverse right now, with new immigrants teeming into that constituency, and it's proof positive that our immigration policy is working and we're retaining. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
The Honourable Member for Preston.
Mr. Speaker, the Heating Assistance Rebate Program is an important program, one which many Nova Scotians rely on to assist them through the cold winter months. However, this program has been underspent for the last several years. Mr. Speaker, can the Minister of Service Nova Scotia Municipal Relations tell the House if Nova Scotians were able to access a full budget allotment for this program in this fiscal year?
The Honourable Minister of Service Nova Scotia and Municipal Relations.
Yes, they were able to access it.
The Honourable Member for Preston on his first supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, the NDP has no problem spending millions of dollars on political advertising. Communications, Nova Scotia costs have tripled over the past few years, and yet the minister can't seem to get the word out about the important program. We are hearing from Nova Scotians who had previously accessed this program that they did not receive the automatic notification and forms which the department promises. Mr. Speaker, will the minister tell the House how many Nova Scotians were not sent notifications and forms this year, and why that didn't happen?
The Honourable Minister of Service Nova Scotia and Municipal Relations.
Mr. Speaker, I think that this question I have answered once a year for 3 years.
The member opposite, I would think, would be aware, because his office actually should have received the applications that all MLAs receive to give out to their constituents. If anybody is coming in there looking for an application, they should be able to get it from him. And if he's had people contacting him because they want to get on the program, what is he doing with those applications? Maybe he just might want to say, I have one here in my office. We get about in the range of 50,000 people who make use of the program. It could be 53,000 this year. And for everyone who has used the program in the past, we mail out an application form to them. Mr. Speaker. We send those applications to a wide variety of non-governmental organizations. They're available at our access centers. All the MLAs get them. We promoted this program through the media, Mr. Speaker. There may be another program that's promoted more widely through government. I can't be sure what that would be, but certainly, his question was, who has not received it? Well, there's 900,000 Nova Scotians. About 50,000 people get it. Do the math.
The honourable member for Cape Breton West.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, my question through you is for the Minister of Natural Resources. As many in this House would know, we are just a few short weeks from the start of lobster season off the Cape Breton community of Manadou. The MV Miner ran aground in September of 2011 on land owned and protected by the province of Nova Scotia. At the time, the land is owned and protected by the province of Nova Scotia. At the time, the Premier said, and I quote, if there's an impact on those fishing grounds, that's going to hurt us. It's now 19 months later. My question to the minister is, what news does the minister have for the people of Manadou regarding the removal of the MV Miner from the protected shores of Scattery?
The Honourable Minister of Natural Resources.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and certainly we understand concern that's in the community of Gabarus and the Cape Breton area, and we recognize the fishery is an important component of the economy in that beautiful area. And certainly we've been working with the community over the months since this unfortunate grounding occurred, but we've had communications not only with the community but also with the federal government, and certainly we've made our position very clear all along that the federal government has full responsibility under the Canada Shipping Act to remove that wreck from the shores of Cape Breton, and we're going to continue to our dialogue with the federal government, with the community. Frank. We very much as anybody want to see that ship removed from the Gabarus area.
The honourable member for Cape Breton West on his first supplementary.
Well, thank you very much, Mr. Speaker, and I want to inform the minister that it's the community of Manadou where this ship is, not the community of Gabarus, as he replied to me twice in his question. The people of Manadou and area have been patient. The Community Development Association. Well,
that's why you don't know.
I mean, the fact is, the ship is off of Manadou. It's not off of Gabarus. That's not my fault. He should know that. Mr. Speaker, the people of Manadou and area have been very patient. Also have the people in Gabarus, but that's another story. The Community Development Association worked with the Bennington Group and with the government. The fishers of the area worked with the government and the Bennington Group as well, and there's still no resolution. The Development Association in Manadou called a summit for January the 22nd of this year. Can the minister tell the residents of Manadou and surrounding areas, indeed all Nova Scotians, why he did not attend this meeting in the community for which he had ample notification, and when will he meet with those people?
The Honourable Minister for Natural Resources.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And I apologize for my geographical error. I know the actual ship is on the shores of Scotterie, certainly near Manadou for sure. But again, we've worked with the community. We were prepared. My deputy minister and several other staff were available on the January 22nd to attend the meeting there with the community. Then it got canceled at the last minute. Unfortunately, my schedule didn't allow that to fit into that day. But we had lots of staff, including right up to the deputy minister, were fully prepared, and we continued the dialogue with the community and with the stakeholders, including the Arvina Navigation, the ship's owner, who has a full responsibility to remove that wreck from the shores of Scotterie, and with the tugboat owners, and certainly with the federal government. We're going to continue to work to find a workable solution here on the shores of Scotterie.
The Honourable Member for Cape Breton West on his final supplementary.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. The community of Manadou has been patient. And the Premier said in October in a Canadian press story, and I quote, he said a lot more than you'll ever say.
He gets to speak. He's allowed to speak. He's allowed to speak.
We don't want to allow it to languish over questions of who is responsible for it. It is not good enough to simply pass this back and forth. I'm not ruling out anything, including taking on the job if necessary. And Mr. Speaker, I've tabled that. It's 19 months later, this issue is still being passed back and forth. Another lobster season, Mr. Speaker, is upon us, and there is still no resolution. The community has waited long enough, Mr. Speaker. They have turned the corner and hit a brick wall. My question to the Premier, when will the Premier finally live up to his own words and help these fellow Nova Scotians who took him at his word?
Honourable the Premier.
Well, Mr. Speaker, I think he needs to reread those words. We said we're not going to pass it back and forth because we recognize that it is the responsibility of the federal government. And it is an extraordinary amount of money that would be taken out of other responsibilities that we already have, Mr. Speaker. This is a matter that should be dealt with, and I have raised it many times. And the member knows, because the member traveled with me to see the federal minister, along with the member from Glace Bay, and along with our minister, in order to identify for the federal minister the responsibility that they had in relation to what we consider to be a very serious matter. So the question I have is simply this. When, I have no idea when, but when will the federal government actually live up to its responsibility with respect to this? I know that this, Mr. Speaker, is a touchy question for the member because he supports the federal government, but nonetheless, he should set aside his partnership and work on behalf of the people of Manadou.
The Honourable Leader of the Official Opposition.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I want to ask the Minister of Transportation, when it comes to the Fitch Road in my constituency, that is a dirt road that leads into the wonderful hydroponic tomato operation run by Denhans, when they can expect to see that road paved?
The Honourable Minister of Transportation Infrastructure Renewal.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I thank the leader of the opposition for his question. If the road is not
order,
listed,
order, please. The time allotted for oral questions put by members to ministers has expired. I will now recognize the government house leader to call government business.
Mr. Speaker, I wish you'd now leave the chair in the house to resolve itself and hold house on supply.
Motion is carried. We will now take a short recess. to allow the minister staff to come into the chamber and set up for the Committee of the Whole House on Supply.
Order, please. The Committee of the Whole House on Supply will come to order. I recognize the Honourable Government House Leader.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Madam Chair, could you please call the estimates for the Minister of Education, Early Childhood Development, E5.
Now call Resolution E5.
Recognize the Honourable Minister of Education and Early Childhood Development.
Thank you very much, Madam Chair. Madam Chair, I wish to thank the Honourable Members for their questions. A debate such as this is an essential part of democracy. If I committed to an Honourable Member to get an answer to a question that I did not have on hand, I will table the answers at a later date. I would also again like to thank Mr. Frank Dunn and Dr. Alan Lowe for assisting me. And I would also like to thank the staff back at the department who helped and quickly responded with answers. And at this point, too, thank them for their hard work on behalf of every child in this province. They do a fantastic job. Our staff always works diligently. I would like to thank the teachers who guide our students in learning and help to ensure they become good citizens. In addition, there are principals, specialists, administrative staff, curriculum experts, custodians, bus drivers, mechanics, and many, many others who work together on behalf of our young people. An education system is a success when everyone is working together in a collaborative way to ensure our children succeed. Madam Chair, the funding for school boards in 2013-14 will rise by $3.3 million. Some members opposite have said school board funding will fall, and they are wrong, Madam Chair. Madam Chair, we are investing $1.047 million for the 2013 year for our children. Per student funding will rise by 3% or $300 to $10,762 in the year 2013-14 school year. This, Madam Chair, is the highest it has ever been. Boards will be able to hire 170 new teachers this year, and we don't anticipate a permanent teacher anywhere in this province will lose their job. Madam Chair, we are presenting a budget that closely matches spending to enrollment declines and provides boards with funding to maintain the current level of high quality and to fund the new and expanded programs outlined in Kids and Learning First. Education funding has been protected and increased, Madam Chair. Three school boards, including Halifax, Annapolis Valley, and CSAP, will see increases in funding. Remaining boards will see decreases in funding, but to protect regions experiencing significant enrollment decline, the decrease was capped at 1.5%. The cap was reduced this year. In order to achieve these caps, the boards that hit the cap received $13.5 million in additional funding, Madam Chair. In the past few years, school boards have had to manage their wage and inflationary cost increases. Madam Chair, that does change with this budget. Boards will no longer have to manage wage increases. Government is providing the total funding to cover wage settlements. There seems to be some confusion, Madam Chair, so I will repeat. Boards no longer have to manage wage increases. Boards will still, like all public sector partners and Nova Scotia families, have to manage the cost of inflation. Government recognizes there are challenges in meeting inflationary costs, so we have assisted boards in other ways, such as changing pension rules to reduce financial pressure, launched a shared services project, and revised the school board funding formula. Madam Chair, we have made it very clear that special needs education must be protected, and we have increased funding again to $141 million. We have also increased our funding for students with special needs by $3.7 million. In the past 2 years, we've increased this important funding by $16 million. With this year's funding, boards will be able to hire 24 more psychologists, speech-language pathologists, and program specialists to help our students with special needs. The funding for teaching assistants was also increased, resulting in funding for 15 additional positions. And, Madam Chair, we have done this while tabling a balanced budget. I would like to commend my colleague, the Minister of Finance, for the work she has done to table a balanced budget with a small surplus, Madam Chair. This budget shows we have turned the corner on the provincial finances, but at the same time, we have protected our special needs funding and increased overall funding to school boards. This shows that we returned this province to balance in a careful and measured way, using a stepwise plan that delivers the vital services our students need. This chamber has heard many times about the major challenge to the public school system, significant enrollment decline being a major one. On the first day of school this past September, there were 2,300 fewer children in school than there was the year before. When the school bell rings and the classes resume this September, there will be 2,300 fewer children. This is the 42nd year of enrollment decline. We have more than 30,000 fewer students in classrooms around the province than 10 years ago. That is the equivalent of 30 full large high schools missing in our province. But over the last decade, more and more money was being spent on education, even while the number of students was in steep decline and the test and achievement results of those that remained improved very little and in many cases not at all and in some areas declined. And this could not continue, Madam Chair. We had to meet these challenges head on. We rebalanced school board funding with $23 million reduction over the past 2 years. This was to reflect that our classes now have far fewer students than 5 years ago. It also reflected that our class sizes were the lowest in a generation. It reflected the fact that while the number of students in this system declined, the number of teachers did not decline. We also sought the advice of education experts, including Dr. Ben Levin, and came up with the Kids and Learning First plan to move confidently and successfully towards a new path. In the throne speech and in Budget 2013, a renewed focus was announced for the department. We are now the Department of Education and Early Childhood Development. Research shows the years from birth to age 6 are the most important in a child's development. Our children deserve the best possible start in life to help them to develop to their full potential. We heard from community members, professionals in the child care sector, and the Early Year Advisory Council that we need a more integrated and accessible approach to providing early years programs and services. With the Department of Education and Early Childhood Education, we're making a strong commitment to parents, families, and children to do just that. And this year, we have budgeted $1.2 million for our youngest children, and we will integrate provincial programs and services for children and families, establish 3 early year centres, and offer free, comprehensive screening of children at age 18 months and 36 months. The concepts of early year centres is exciting. We will establish 3 early year centres across the province that will provide support for young children and their families at the accessible location in their community. These centres build on the highly successful Schools Plus model being used in schools and will help bring seamless access to regulated childcare, early learning programs, early intervention, and parent education. We are also working with the McCain Foundation on our early years efforts. It is an exciting time ahead for the Department of Education and Early Childhood Development, Madam Chair. Over the past year, we have begun or expanded 39 initiatives of our Kids and Learning First plan, including expanding Succeeding in Reading, introducing a new math curriculum, and keeping class sizes low by having a class cap. Madam Chair, we will continue to implement the plan to ensure every student succeeds. Madam Chair, I move the resolution for the Department of Education and Early Childhood Development to end the estimates debate. Be it resolved that a sum not exceeding $1,105,000,000 $659,000 be granted to the Lieutenant Governor to defray expenses in respect of the Department of Education and Early Childhood Development pursuant to the estimate. Thank you, Madam Chair. I will now take my place.
Thank you. Shall the resolution stand? The resolution is stood. Yes, we'll just take a brief recess. There will be another resolution before the committee, and we'll allow the staff to leave, and we'll set up for the next one. And we'll thank you. Brief recess. Go ahead. Yeah. Order, please. Committee on Supply will come back to order. Recognize the Honourable Government House Leader.
Madam Chair, could you please call the estimates for the Minister of Economic and Rural Development and Tourism and the following resolutions, E4, E26, E42, and E49. Thank you.
Thank you. Now call resolutions E4, E26, E42, and E49. And recognize the Honourable Minister for Economic and Rural Development and Tourism.
Thank you, Madam Chair. And I want to say thank you for the opportunity to speak about this year's budget for economic, rural development and tourism and the important work being done by the department. I'm pleased to introduce several people who are here with me today. I'm joined to my left by Simon D'Entremont, Deputy Minister for the department, and to my right, Darlene O'Neill, our Manager of Financial Services. I'd also like to welcome senior staff from our economic development agencies who are in the gallery today. And I would introduce Mr. Stephen Lund, President and CEO of Nova Scotia Business Inc., Colin McLean, President and CEO of the Waterfront Development Corporation, Scott Ferguson, President and CEO of Trade Center Limited, Stephen Duff, our new CEO of InnovaCorp, and Carolyn Horton, acting CEO of Film and Creative Industries, Industries Nova Scotia, that is, and another new CEO who is, I don't know if Lisa is with us today, but also Lisa Bugden, who will join us as the new CEO of Film and Creative Industries Nova Scotia, and also Patrick Sullivan, Nova Scotia Tourism Agency. Of course, as much as I'd like, our entire staff can't join us today in the gallery, but we do have a number of them here. ERD is served by dedicated and hardworking people in branches that include investment and trade, regional planning and development, productivity and innovation, procurement, policy and planning, the Nova Scotia Gateway Secretariat, and of course, we're supported by finance, human resources, and communications. Madam Chair, not very long ago, Nova Scotia was facing a very bleak economic future. Now, our great province is starting to turn the corner. We are putting 20 years of slow economic growth behind us and looking forward to a future of unprecedented opportunity. As I travel Nova Scotia and talk with young people, with business owners, and with families, I feel a renewed sense of optimism and energy. Nova Scotia is indeed starting to turn the corner, and we are doing the work to keep the economy growing and moving forward. Thank you. In 2012, Nova Scotia reached a record high level of employment and welcomed one of the most significant weeks in job creations in the last decade when IBM and projects announced they would create nearly 1,000 new jobs in Nova Scotia. Jobs here, our plan to grow the economy, is helping hundreds of small businesses get started, expand into new markets, make productivity upgrades, and train employees now and for the future. Preparations to make the most of opportunities like shipbuilding, the Maritime Link, record offshore exploration commitments, and a renewed and innovative forestry sector have gained momentum, and Madam Speaker, they are moving forward. By working together and making smart strategic investments, the province is helping to create good jobs and growing Nova Scotia's economy. Madam Speaker, in 2013-14 budget for economic and rural development and tourism is approximately $130 million. This is a decrease of $57 million over the 2012-2013 departmental budget. This decrease is primarily due to a $44 million reduction in the Nova Scotia Jobs Fund. These one-time funds were invested in strengthening the forestry industry last year, helping to support thousands of jobs and help grow the economy in rural Nova Scotia. The department has also found administrative and efficiency savings and streamlined processes to better support small businesses in Nova Scotia. Madam Chair, as you can see, a great deal has been accomplished over the past year, and there is much to look forward to. Nova Scotians have plenty to be optimistic about. This budget will help us advance along the path forged through Jobs Here, a path that has seen businesses become more innovative, businesses become more productive, and businesses become more competitive. A path that is cutting red tape and helping small businesses more easily access programs and services that will help them hire, innovate, and grow. A path that is helping us make the most of the unprecedented opportunities that are in front of us. We will continue to give young people better access to skills and training programs so they can make the most of the opportunities that are coming our way. Madam Chair, we will continue to make smart, strategic investments in businesses, businesses that are committed to creating good jobs here in Nova Scotia. Nova Scotia is starting to turn the corner, and we will keep that progress moving forward. Thank you, Madam Chair, and I'm certainly happy to take any and all questions.
Thank you. Recognize the Honourable Member for Glace Bay.
Thank you, Madam Chair, and I thank the Minister for those opening comments and appreciate the fact that he left lots of time for us to just have some conversations about this year's fiscal budget and what the direction of the department is. I would also like to thank all staff who are here from ERDT, of course, Simone, and the other representatives in the gallery today, ERDT, of course, NSBI, and InnovaCorps, the Secretariat, the RENs, who are doing great work on the ground in respective communities. You know, certainly there are points where we disagree and things that we challenge, and I'm certainly comfortable in the positions what we've taken and I've taken on particular investments, and with all due respect, I know that those individuals who support those decisions are doing it for the right reasons, and we're trying to grow the economy. So certainly this will be a respectful exchange and a respectful conversation about the direction of ERDT. So I do thank those staff members and those individuals for being here today. I just want to open up, and the minister talked about the reduction in the budget. And with a lot of that, the $46 million being allocated for the forestry strategy that was last year. I just will quickly, before we get into some of the line by line, I want to ask a few questions about the forestry sector and some of those allocations. So my first question, were the monies provided for the forestry sector in 2011-12, are they entirely allocated or they're elements of this year's budget that will continue to go to some of the forestry investments?